software center community. And being back as a representative for Toyota. I have the honor to present Toyota for you here today. I work as a manager for a group of product owners, UX, system architects, and technical writers here at Toyota. We are located in Frihamnen, here in Gothenburg. So I will go through Toyota and I will start a bit wide, a bit with our history. And who we are, because I guess most people here recognize the Toyota brand as such, but it might not be obvious what kind of company we are. Obviously, we do make cars, but we do other things as well. So I'll start a bit wide, and then I will drill down more in detail to what we are doing here in Gothenburg. So looking a bit at our history. 1867, Mr. Toyota was born, and then he started, he made an innovation, a textile machinery called a loom in English, or a weaving machinery, if you will. That was the first Toyota product, and then he founded the Toyota Industries Corporation in 1926. Moving on a bit, the first car that Toyota produced was produced in 1936. And on the other side of the globe, namely in Mjölby in Sweden, another company was formed to support the building and transport business in Sweden. It was a company called BT, Building and Transport Economy. And this company was, the goal was to help moving goods. Lean production, or as we call it in Toyota, the Toyota production system, more or less, I guess, revolutionized the world within production in the 80s and forward. The first draft of the Toyota production system was issued in 1953. And used in the car production facilities. We move forward a bit. We talked a bit about the Swedish company, BT. We also made an innovation. We made this that most of you have probably seen. It's called an SJ pallet back in the days. Now it's called a Euro pallet. It's this pallet that goods are placed on. In a standard format, so you can move goods around efficiently. It was actually more or less a groundbreaking idea at those times. So the BT company continued to develop and worked with moving goods or material handling, focusing on goods that were on a pallet and moved by trucks or forklifts. And the year 2000, Toyota Industry Corporation acquired BT Industries in Mjölby. And from that point in time, they became a part of the Toyota family. So very, very short about our history. If we move on a bit and look at the Toyota group from another perspective, we do have 16 corporations within Toyota, several different brands, and these 16 corporations are working in four different business sectors. The most obvious is the automotive industry, but actually the automotive industry is around one third of our business. The really large sector within the Toyota Industry Corporation is material handling, which my company Logistics Solution is a part of. You can also see that the textile machinery still exists in Toyota, even if it's a few. Sorry? No, I heard a song. I will continue. But material handling is really, really the big thing with Toyota, which myself, I didn't know when I started in Toyota. So that's two thirds of what we do. Some other numbers that can be worth looking at. If we look at trucks, and when I say trucks, I mean forklifts, that some people call them. But if we look at the number of trucks that we have in Europe on a service agreement today, that's above 400,000 trucks. You can add another 100,000 trucks in Europe, so we have more than 500,000 trucks running around, probably as we speak, and moving goods around. And Toyota has in Europe maybe 22-23% of the European market. So there are a couple of millions of trucks moving around in Europe. And now I talk about manual trucks, manual vehicles today, but it's still a pretty significant fleet. The factory in Mjölby that I talked about is one of the world's most modern lean production facilities. It produces some 80-90,000 vehicles each year. And Toyota Material Handling Europe has a strong local presence in many of our countries. And in many of the countries as well, there are several service offices in each country. So strong presence in Europe. A lot of vehicles that are being produced, and we have a significant fleet of vehicles. But these again are the manual vehicles, and I work with automation. So the question then is, of all these vehicles, how many vehicles are automatic vehicles? And to understand this figure, could be good to know that Toyota's worked for a while, for quite some years, to gain knowledge within the area of automation. And we started very small. For some 10 years ago, Logistics Solution was formed. Before that, some other activities was done with automated vehicles as well. But it started in a small scale with the purpose of getting the know-how to build automatic vehicles and getting to know the market. So we are approaching 1,000 automatic vehicles in Europe as we speak at a couple of 100 customer sites. We have sites where we have up to 60 vehicles. I think we have one special site in England where we have 120 vehicles. So that is our largest sites with vehicles, and with site I mean a warehouse or production facility. And then we have a lot of systems as well that are smaller with a couple of vehicles. But if you look at the number with 500,000 vehicles that are just manual Toyota vehicles, and we have automated 1,000, I would dare to say that of these 500,000 vehicles, there's a lot of vehicles that are running in processes that fits very well to be automated. They are repetitive, they have a steady pace and so forth. So we believe that there is a huge market out there up for grabs. And that means that we are now narrowing in what we are doing here in my company. And we started small, as I mentioned, for some 10 years ago. And it was to understand the business and to understand the technology and actually to build a foundation for growth. So you can say that the purpose of the company I'm in now is to be ready to scale. Of course, we believe that software is a key enabler for this. You, of course, must have software when it comes to automating the fleet. But also that we use software maybe all the way from our sales activities until we commission our vehicles and service and support and so forth. So software is a key. We are a software company. One mission we have as well, I mentioned that we have a strong local presence in Europe with some 30 companies where each in some 30 countries and where each country has several offices. So we have a strong local presence there, and we want to help those local companies to sell and deploy these systems. And that kind of indicates that we need to have a robust system that are user-friendly and easy to deploy and so forth. Yeah, I guess the hockey stick is a famous famous idea that some point in time, the sales really take off. Again, if you see that there are a lot of vehicles driving around in Europe that fits very well to be automated, we believe that some point in time when the customer is ready and the technology is mature enough and so forth, we believe that there will be quite a significant takeoff in this business. So the purpose of the organization I'm in is to prepare for the scale up of the business. So that was very short about our history and background and the purpose of my organization. Let's look a bit about logistics solutions and the products and solutions that we have. So now I'm narrowing down a bit from the big Toyota Industry Corporation company to my company. But in order to understand the product and services, let's talk a few minutes about in what area exactly we work. So either if you have a production facility or if you have a warehouse or a combination of both, everything starts at the bottom here where you have lorries that comes with goods of some kind. It can be a production site where you build cars, it can be a distribution center for food or anything, but the goods come in. And as soon as the goods is delivered, then our work starts, because you might want to store the goods not at the docking place where the lorries comes. You might want to store it for a longer period, maybe in what you call a high density storage. You might have a production that you want to move goods in to in a on demand or in a steady pace. And then when you have worked in production with the goods, you might want to store it again, and then you want to ship it out. So basically, this is the area we play in. We work with intra-logistics, the logistics that we have between four walls. But when we offer automated solutions for this area that I talked about here, we offer it as turnkey solution. Some vital part of it is that we have specialists in product management that knows how to run this project and set them up. The automation software is the area that I work in and the department I work in. And I will dig in a bit deeper into our software and explain a bit more about what it is. We have our vehicles, automated vehicles that are designed and developed in Mjölby, 30 minutes south of Linköping. And then we also offer service and support, 24/7 service and support for those who want it, or a bit less ambitious for other customers who want a lower SLA. But this is logistic solutions, service and product offering that we have here. So just to talk a bit about the software that we have then, to give you a concrete example, this is a simplified example. What you see here is a warehouse that you're looking from above. And what the brown boxes here are pallets that are stored. So what happened then is that in the warehouse or in the production facility, you need something to be picked up, something to be moved. The first thing you have to that you have to choose here is what vehicle should be chosen for the pickup. Here you have 8 vehicles. And which one of them is the best one to choose? When you've chosen the vehicle, you're inside in an environment where people walk around. You might also have manual truck drivers driving around. So you usually have a combination of both. Then the system automatically needs to pick a proper vehicle and assign a good path through the environment for that vehicle. So that's where the task starts. And then a vehicle comes and pick up a pallet. And then, let's see what happened now. And let's see. Yep, it picks up a pallet. And when it picks up a pallet, then you might not, in that moment, you might not know where the pallet is going to be placed. So in this case, you move on to a scanner, and the scanner gets some information, and it might ask the SAP system for an address of where to store the goods. And then it gets the information to go to where it should put the goods. So again, a simplified picture, just moving one pallet or moving one piece of goods around in a facility is probably not super difficult. You don't need super advanced software for that. But the challenge comes when you realize that you have a lot of people in an area where a 2-ton truck is moving around. You also have usually requirements on capacity. Maybe 3 p.m. in the afternoon, some 7-8 lorries are coming to pick up goods, and you need to fill out the docks, and you need to fill out the docks efficiently using a total fleet of trucks in an efficient way. And you need to pick up and store it in an efficient way, and that needs to be robust, it needs to be secure. You might also need some traceability if some goods are lost on the way. So when you add those requirements, it quickly starts to get complex. And another challenge that we have is that even though all our customers are moving things, usually it's a big difference if you're moving around food and beverages or if you're moving around components in a car production facility. So the customers usually have their own business rules and special needs of the system that we supply. And that's where the complication starts. So we started up, as mentioned, some 10 years ago. And when we did that, we started building a software specific for each customer, and specific, we developed our software in our customer project, and we kind of reached the end of the line after a while with that setup, because at the end we ended up with a monolith that was pretty inflexible, difficult to work with, and we sketched on a new solution, and the challenge here was really to make the system configurable in a way that doesn't create a new kind of spaghetti system. But so we wanted to have a standardized base software that was able to customize for each customer. And a year or so, we went all in to develop this new software that is part of our software suite now, where we have this rule-based engine that we believe we have a really good balance between a standardization of a structure and modules in that, and then customization that we believe that we can customize the behavior for each, the business logic for each customer. And we can do it in different hierarchies as well and so forth. So we believe we have built a pretty powerful software engine here. And let's see if I can, not this one. Yeah, and the software that we are building then and how we are doing it. We decided that we could not continue on the old software base. So we worked a couple of years to sketch on an architecture, and we choose containers and microservices that are being managed via the Docker software, and we release it on Linux releases. We have, as you can see here, we have different databases for different needs. So we pick the technology we believe solve the specific problem, business problem that we have. In the middle, we have the Toyota values, challenge, continuous improvement, be data-driven, go to the source. We believe in respect for each other and teamwork. And we also have the safe framework. The reason why we brought in the safe framework was that when we realized that we need to develop this in a bigger scale, we need to go away from customer projects and building the software for each customer. Then we saw that SAFE provided a framework with roles and structures that we could benefit from. And being in Gothenburg, you had access to a good pool of competence for SAFE. So we choose SAFE. But now we are talking about that we are beyond SAFE because we have adapted SAFE to our needs. Made it more Toyota-ish, if you will. So I think I'm running out of time because Helena asked me to save 5 minutes for Q's and A's. And that was actually my last slide.